feedback from Josh Galecki, a solo game dev based in Cleveland. He fell in love with roguelikes after playing Dungeon Crawl Stone Soup. Are we playing a recording for Josh?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, cool.
Okay. All right, great. We have that up. Yes, he fell in love with roguelikes after playing Dungeon Crawl Stone Soup 15 years ago and loves the emergent narratives created by the genre. Previous releases include Moondrop, a non-violent farming roguelike, Within a Dead City, and Dwarven Depths.
All right. Hello, Roguelike Celebration. This is my talk, Procedurally Generating Puzzles. So, a mathematician and an engineer are sitting in the faculty lounge when the coffee machine catches on fire, as they do. The engineer rushes to the sink, fills up a bucket with water, and then douses the flames. The next day, the two teachers are in the faculty lounge again, and the coffee machine catches on fire again. The mathematician rushes to the sink, fills the bucket with water, and hands it off to the engineer. They then proudly proclaim, "And now we've reduced it to a problem we know how to solve." Hi, I'm Josh Galecki, solo game dev of Moonroof Studios, and today I'll be talking about how to include puzzles in a roguelike game. Now, puzzles are very common in video games. They help change the pace, which can be important in a more action-oriented game. They give the player a challenge and provide that flash of insight, that aha moment that so many people love. Whole genres of video games are founded on puzzles. But solving a puzzle once is fun, solving it twice is trivial, and solving it for the 20th time is a chore. Roguelikes, I'd argue, are designed around repetition. Given that, how do you include puzzles? Now, this was a bit of a personal challenge for me as well. I made a non-violent farming roguelite called Moondrop. Now, I didn't want to include any combat or even combat-like mechanics in this game. But without combat, how do you challenge the player? How do you keep them engaged while they explore the quote-unquote dungeon? The answer I arrived at was to include puzzles in the game. I knew, though, that because of repetition, I would have to design puzzle systems rather than individual puzzles. These puzzle systems, much like your random level generator, would be able to generate a random puzzle on demand. Now, back in college, I studied both math and computer science, and sometimes I would see the same problem in both classes. In the math class, we would prove that a solution existed for this problem, whereas in computer science, we would examine an algorithm that gave you a solution for the problem. So, like the mathematician, we just want to show that a solution to the puzzle exists. There's two major strategies. I call them the analytic and the constructive. The analytic is showing that any generated puzzle has to be solvable. And the constructive is building a particular puzzle so that it has a known solution. First thing, we're going to take a look at the analytic strategy. There's a classic video game puzzle and handheld game puzzle known as Lights Out. This involves turning all the switches on or off. Whenever you toggle a switch, it also toggles its neighbors to their opposite state. I included this in Moondrop 2. When the player encounters this puzzle on the shady trail, they must turn all of these lantern columns on. On the right-hand side of the slide, you can see a schematic diagram of one possible board state. Here I show two lanterns are on and six are off. Now, in order to solve all possible puzzles in this space, it helps to know what interesting properties your puzzle design might possess. The first thing we're going to look at is that an undo move is simple. If a player toggles switch A twice in a row, then there is no change to the puzzle state. It starts off blank and ends up blank. Now we can extend that a little more. We can even throw a move in between these two toggles. If a player toggles switch A, then toggle switch B, then switch A again, it's the same puzzle state as if the player only ever toggled switch B. In essence, the two A toggles cancel each other out, regardless of how many moves you have in between them. So what I now want to show is that I can toggle on any switch on or off without affecting any of the others. I have a couple of GIFs here. They show that I can toggle on the top left corner. They'll both start at the blank state right here and right here. So I can show that I can toggle on the top left corner and in here, the top middle corner. There's the top left and one more, two more. Here's the top middle. So there's a series of moves that let me toggle any of these switches on or off at will without changing the board state outside of those switches. So that's great for these two switches, but what about the other six? Well, the puzzle also has interesting property number three, that the puzzle board is symmetric. I can switch or flip-flop any of these move sequences horizontally or vertically, and in doing so, I can reach the other six switches and be able to turn them on and off at will. So since any individual switch can be toggled on without affecting the state of the others, and there must be some set of moves that solves any given puzzle on this 2x4 layout. However many switches start off, I can just make sure I toggle those ones on and the puzzle is solved. That means that I can generate any initial configuration of on and off lanterns, and I know that a solution exists. Also, a little nifty thing, because of that canceling out property, I know that a minimal move sequence to solve a puzzle has at most 8 moves, because each switch can be toggled 0 or 1 times. If there's a switch that needs to be toggled twice for a solution, then really it's the same as it not being toggled at all. So I can create, you know, all but one lantern on. I can create opposite corners on. What are the solutions for these puzzles? You know, I'm not really sure. Honestly, I'll let the engineers handle that one. So next up, we're going to take a look at this constructive strategy. Here, we're building up a puzzle so that it has a known solution. I call this particular puzzle the River Grid. It might be one of the more complicated puzzles in the game, at least from a design standpoint. Here, a river flows in a 4x4 directed graph. Directed here means that just like a real river, it flows one ways, not both ways. Here, the river flows down and to the right. Dams are placed alongside the edges of the grid, and they can block the water flow behind them. In order to solve the puzzle, the player must figure out which dams to open and close in order to have the right level of water at specific vertices or intersections on the grid. We'll go through what that means and how that gets built up here. So this is a schematic diagram of the empty river grid without any dams. Water comes in from the top, splits along the outer set of vertices on the left and the right, and then recombines on this inner set of vertices, which is kind of where the puzzle happens. Vertices and edges can both have a water level between 0 and 3. Vertex's water level is found by adding the value of its incoming edges. So this vertex here, this edge has a strength of 1, this edge has a strength of 1, so this vertex has a water level of 2. 2 is also what this vertex spits out to the nodes farther down the river. First thing we do is we add 2 locked dams to random locations, and you can see how that changes the water levels behind those dams. Next, we add 3 more dams. These dams are must-close dams for the known solution that we are generating. They are toggleable by the player. Once we have these, we pick 4 vertices as the solution vertices. We note the level of water in each of these 4 vertices, and the player must toggle switches until they get all 4 of these with the correct water level. Next, we add 3 must open dams. The player needs to have all of these open for our known solution. Finally, I randomly open and close all these dams before the player arrives. The player finds the puzzle, and I am satisfied knowing that there is at least one solution for it. There could be more than one. I'm cool with that. But I know that it is a solvable puzzle. It has to be, because that's the way I built it. So with constructive strategies, it's easiest to have something like the previous one where you generate the solution in the middle of your you generate the solution in the middle of the creation of it, but it's also possible to start without a solution, and then you search until you find one. This works great for mazes because of the way they get built. In this video, you see the wheat maze. Each tile of the maze is either passable or not. The tiles all look the same, though, and the player isn't easily able to see their location. So here's the construction algorithm for it. I won't go into too much detail, but I will note that there is a list of open tiles in orange, possible tiles in red, and wall tiles in black. At each round of maze construction, we take a possible tile that has exactly one open neighbor, and we make it open. If it has more than one open neighbor, it becomes a wall. This gives us a branching maze that usually spans the grid and doesn't contain any loops. I say usually because there is a set of circumstances where this algorithm can fail. In fact, it narrowly avoids it doing so right at the end here. Blink and you missed that. Let's see that in slow motion. At the end of maze generation, there are two possibly open tiles left. If the algorithm randomly picks this one on the right instead of the one on the left, the one on the left gets marked as a wall. Now the maze has no solution and the player is sad. If your algorithm is searching for the solution, you have to be aware of any bugs where it might not reach the solution. In math speak, you have to look for the counterexample. What could go wrong? So when you find that counterexample, you can fix it. It's possible to guard against them. In the wheat maze, the gold tile of the maze looks for an open neighbor. If it can't be found, it creates a path towards the start tile until an open neighbor is found. This guarantees a solution to the maze, even if that nice no looping property isn't intact at the end of that. So, summing things up, puzzles are great. I love them. Doing the same puzzle more than once is not so great. Puzzle systems let you give the player lots of variants on the same puzzle design and keep them interested. Of course, any puzzle you create needs to be solvable. If you know they can be solved, you can let the player do the hard work. Solving a puzzle space analytically means showing that any initial configuration of that puzzle can be solved. Generating a solvable puzzle constructively also guarantees a solution. When doing this, it's easiest to start off with a solution and then add red herrings, trap doors, or false paths. But it's also possible to build up to a solution. If so, like any other algorithm you make, you have to pay extra attention to the bugs. I'd like to thank the organizers for throwing an amazing conference. I'd like to thank you all for coming and listening to my talk. I have a couple of places you could follow me here, and I'm ready for any questions.
Excellent. If anyone is quick enough on the draw, we might be able to do one question, but only if they post it right away. But that was a great talk. I think it's a really useful toolbox. It feels like one of those ones that'll be good to reference. I can see how those techniques expand outwards to you could flavor those puzzles in a lot of different ways and get a lot of mileage out of it. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, there's a number of different tools from math too. Graph theory offers a really rich set of ways to generate puzzles or ideas for doing so.
Right. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I love the inspiration from mathematics. Cool. Okay, I think that... Okay, well, here's a quick one from Tessoralis. How did you determine which puzzles you wanted in your game?
It was a kind of a general build-up. I have four elemental dungeons on the mountaintop, and trying to find different cozier themed puzzles to go with it. You know, obviously you're not falling into a pit of lava or anything like that in this game. So just kind of taking a look at, like, for on the damp trail, you have fishing, you have this river grid puzzle and things like that. So kind of looking for interesting math problems and seeing if I could give them a theme that fits with what I'm going for.
Excellent. Wonderful. Thank you so much. And perfect job fitting even the question answer into exactly your time slot. So thank you so much, Josh.
Thank you.